I guess I'll introduce myself first. I'm Glace, Patio Guy. You probably know me if you're watching and listening to this anyways.
I'm Bear. This is our, 10th episode of the podcast?
I don't know. I lost count.
I am Sammy, the resident Laranoa player, also retired resident player. Every other character doesn't matter. It's only Laranoa, you know what I'm saying?
I heavily disagree with that statement, but go ahead.
Dang. let me ruffle my feathers. It's been 3 years. I'm like an old man now, you know what I'm saying?
God.
Hey there. I'm Xehanort, or as I go by now, NordVPN. I'm the good old vet of Diol and off-meta warpath warlord person. Yeah.
Can we use that? We're not sponsored.
See, it's a one little difference, don't worry. Our services are very different. Trust me.
Hi, I'm Darren. I am an Alazri player, ex-veteran DL player, who used to play a lot of the community, helping out with looking for games, and people who just want to clear content.
Hi, I'm Donke. You might know me as the guy who saved up a million summons, who kept sort of a summon tracker, and who pretty much cleared all the content without really having to roll.
Yeah, happy birthday, Donkey.
Yeah,
happy birthday.
Thanks. Happy birthday, yeah, wonderful. That's exactly what I wanted to hear. Yep.
Did you ever actually spend everything? I can't remember, Donkey.
No. Nope. I didn't. No, I kept all that shit.
Not like we can, because we have some unfortunate news for those who aren't really aware. Our precious Dragalia lost is now truly lost, and is no longer playable on any apps or anything else right now. It's been shut down.
It's been like that for like a year now.
We just wanted to take some time to sort of reflect on our time there and look back at things that might have been great, bad, or maybe somewhere in the middle. But yeah, we gotta send this thing off somehow, so I think this would be a good way to do it.
I think we're going through loss. Are we doing this like it's fucking...
Yes, that is
like how we're acting like... Like some shit. Yeah, the war did happen.
Bro, the waifu war isn't your fault. You don't need to blame yourself for it. Would have been dead, though, if they monetized better.
Probably could have done Battle Pass or something like that. Like, grinding was a problem, I would say. Like, you definitely got a lot of Eldwater or anything like that. Like, even at the end of DL's life, I didn't have enough Eldwater to upgrade every unit. There was no way to get at least a decent amount of Eldwater fast.
I mean, they did give out the crystals that, like, maxed you out entirely. And they themselves said, oh, you can use them freely. But why didn't they monetize those?
I feel like, because at that point, they already knew that the game was, like, gonna be shut down, so they're just like, you know what, here, you can have these items that just instamax everything, you can do whatever you want, and go crazy before EOS.
I guess, yeah, they probably knew by that point that they were going under.
I do wish that they did provide us a option to, like, use these excess mana as the resources, because I have a buttload of mana.
Yeah, I was capped on mana for the last, like, 6 months of the game or so. I was capped on it, and it was really, really bad. Had to, like, my mailbox was just full every single time.
Yeah, to be fair, you didn't upgrade any other units that you didn't have, so...
Yeah, to be fair, Donkey, you had, like, hardly anything.
I mean, it isn't as if I was the only person that capped, because there were plenty of other people. I mean, the only difference is that those people, whenever they capped, they could just be like, oh, I'll just build this unit I don't care about. Meanwhile, I ran out of those.
I did that sometimes, too. It would have been cool if they made, like, exclusive, like, flex weapon skins.
And I remember that New Year's paddle they released as, like, a little weapon skin early on that you could pay for? I wish they could have did something more with that instead of just doing it one time and never doing it for the rest of the game's lifespan.
I don't think that was the only thing that they needed to do, to be honest. They needed to do a lot more in terms of monetization.
Yeah, like a battle pass.
Not even like cosmetics and stuff, the actual game systems. Because I cleared the game without spending any of my summons, aside from like the first banner or whatever. That shouldn't be possible. That really, like, there's no other gacha game that I've played where you can just hoard for forever and still manage to do every single piece of content that's available.
Yeah, because you cleared both solo and co-op, right?
Yeah, both solo and co-op was all done. I like co-op maybe, but there's no way I should have been able to do solo for everything.
Yeah, like I hate Power Creep as much as the next guy. I'm a Fire Emblem Heroes player, but it's like you definitely like at least sorry when the game is that old, because like the game was like 4 years old or something like that when it finally kicked the bucket or something. Like when a game is that old, you shouldn't be able to clear the solo in-game content without at least like needing actually like some premium stuff.
Yeah, and honestly, if you did decide to pull, I gotta wonder like, how was the gacha for people in their time span here for anyone who did pull? I'm sorry, Donkey. Don't get it.
Okay. Whatever. Whatever. Okay.
Boo, Donkey.
I mean, for me, I was practically free to play. I never spent any money on the game. I'm gonna get piked or something, but I've gotten all limited units besides one, and it was Gala. Godric, was it?
To be fair, Godric is pretty
And I don't know, I did pretty well. Like, there was no good reason to summon or even spend money on the game.
As far as my summons, I never ended up getting the only Gala bow in the game. So I don't know if I'm a real bow main at the end of the day. I feel like that's kind of underwhelming. But it was solid. I did put in a little bit into the game, but I don't know. I feel like you could have played regardless with money, without money, and you'd still be fine.
Yeah, I feel like they definitely could have done more with the base weapons that we already had. So you know how the mana caster had three different types? So what if they went back and changed certain weapon types to have those multiple functions, so they don't have to keep creating these complex kits just to sell more units?
I get what you mean, but they were kind of already doing that with some, like, I think they should have added a dual sword unit there, because they did enough like dual weapon units as is to justify unique kits.
I mean, they technically did.
They technically did, yes. Wasn't it the axes that they put dual swords over or something like that? But yeah, no, I think definitely like more than just like, they could have added more than just one weapon type, I definitely feel, or just like variations of it.
Yeah, because like for something, for example, for me, like I wish we had like a throwing axe type where like you didn't have to be close range, because axes were probably the worst class to play. At least I didn't enjoy them. Like normal axe was super slow, and it was just, it didn't feel like they had a lot of fun with the hit or whatever. But if there was like a range axe where you just tap to throw axes so you could just kite the boss, that'd be great. Or if you had like a really heavy axe where you get a lot of SP but your attacks are super slow, like if we had variations between like the normal kits, that'd be great.
I think they kind of experimented like that with Summer Padia. Actually, I know me, big Padia guy, talking about Padia. Her kit was mostly focused on force striking with range to build up huge amounts of SP, but she didn't attack much. You got like one force strike every like 2 seconds or something like that because of all the animations, but you were mostly skill based because of that, and it was kind of fun. I do think that if they went forward with the kind of similar kind of class like that, more focus on that instead of just like one or two gimmick units, that could have been really cool.
Well, I do believe that in their own way of trying to tackle that issue is by creating unique attack animation types for specific type of weapons. Some of the characters have unique attack animations. For example, like Belina, when she's in Dragon Drive, she's not like a standard dagger character per se, using combos. So that's kind of like how they tackled it. Then they introduced mana casters, which back then we all assumed that you could have switched the forms in between, like however the playstyle you want to play with. But instead, what they did was they preset it for each and every release of mana caster characters to their own mana caster types. So there wasn't really much variety in terms of like mana casters, and some just straight up outclassed the other.
I feel like even going on top of that, where we had mana spirals, certain mana spirals could actually let you change your style of auto attacking. I know axes in the past, we used to have the little leap to let you charge your force strike in the air, which for some people is just it's nothing really big, but if you're actually a fan of axe, that used to help with DPS and just force striking in general. So if some axes could throw an axe and it kind of just spins in the air and comes back to you like a boomerang, that could be kind of cool. Those little things that you put into the game to try and change up the way you play, even, for example, if you throw an axe on the floor, it's kind of like a bomb and you can pick it up and throw it again, or it'll just explode. Those type of kits, it stops making you feel you have to play the game in one linear way, because certain prints would work differently, certain playstyles would work differently. Finally, you'd start to use dragons differently, which we were getting to, but it just felt like it was a heavy focus on just farming solo or farming fast.
Yeah. And I would have loved to enjoy so many of these unique kits, but one big issue was just how the bosses over time were starting to get designed. And I think in general, that started limiting some of the options we had in terms of playstyles. And the game, I think, as a whole, just suffered for that.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of bosses were, a boss is a boss, you do close up stuff, but it's just almost every single boss was, you need to be close up and you bait the boss for X, Y, and Z. And because of that and how a lot of bosses function, a lot of units were dead on release that would have been really unique playstyles otherwise. Grimnir, I remember, once you build up his combo enough, you would do like the kind of like boomerang thing with his lance and stuff like that. It was super cool, but the only way you really got to go that far was by auto attacking for like a minute straight, or you defeated so many enemies that match. And it's just like, in a boss attack, you can't really do that effectively in time. And it just sucked. Some units just missed out on a lot of cool stuff like that just because of the boss design.
They only really capitalize on that stuff at the end with units like Basilius. Was it Asura or whatever fight it was? Because you got him on second phase and you would automatically be fully unlocked at that point, and then you would be just going like totally like apeshit with your kid and stuff like that. If he was in the first phase, then it would be like really, really hard to capitalize on him. Because you bring the hot boss down to half and it's like, oh, that kit's useless now. Which is, I don't know, there's a lot of weird designs in this game.
Yeah, I think Nedric probably suffered it from the most, because the second you get Bahamut, the phase is already over. You don't get to use the broken part of his kit. He is a strong unit, but everyone considered him not that great because he took so long to get set up. And like, I think the boss, like the levels aren't that great. I mean, it's been in a circle for all 4 years.
In a circle. Honestly, I think this game suffered from smaller parts of the game not really being usable as much. I know Void Dragons existed, but it kind of got to a point where it was just an auto battler, and the entire essence of DL was just optimize your characters for AI to kind of run the game for you and just kind of watch it. See, a lot of people didn't get to actually enjoy the difficulty of bosses, which, yeah, on one part, it's a mobile game, so you don't want to actually stress yourself out. But on the other part, it's still rewarding. It used to be rewarding to kind of fight a lot of these designs, but a lot of it just became dead content or speed through content or farming content, things like that.
And man, I have some things to say about how the auto system in general and just how people started focusing on that over time, and even the devs started focusing on it, because came into this game, the biggest draw was the co-op function and just how much we had to work together and strategize to overcome most of the game's challenges, especially in the High Dragon era. And the fact that that sort of camaraderie and strategy is just, that the fact that it just got lost over time so hard, I really think did this game in.
Yeah, because I always felt like DL wasn't a solo game, but it just slowly became one. Everyone started autoing stuff and units got so strong where they could just auto everything. Even, I'm pretty sure someone autoed Legend Lilith or something like that. It got so easy.
Yeah, there were many videos of people doing their best just to build teams that could auto. Even if the reliability was 10%, 5%, they would do it. And they would try their darndest to auto and make videos on it. And there's Dragalia-related, right? Dragalia-related, that website that was just solely for submitting auto team builds for each piece of content.
I do remember that as well. I mean, I use that website myself sometimes too. That was mostly just for times when I couldn't labor by myself, but I do agree that the game as a whole kind of became way too auto-centralized, especially as content progressed and as the main player base, like the local player base, moved to each boss fight. Previous content became irrelevant. The previous player still needed to farm it. That was the main issue, and that's kind of why I wish they can't found ways to bring players back to it and not throw out the mentor system. That was horrible, but bring players back to old ones to discourage so much auto. I think half rewards wasn't really enough of a discouragement.
Well, in terms of why most players decide to auto is because, not to be like too frank, but I don't think the game is at first suited for everyone, as it requires a player to like know the fight and have a certain skill to like at least clear the fight with other people. Someone just messes up, the fight is just lost, because teamwork is really, really important in co-op fights, especially like when back in the day when there was no mana spirals whatsoever, which means one single mistake would just flop the run and then you have to restart all over again. So with the addition of like new mana spirals and new updates to 2.0 and stuff, I believe that it somewhat made it more possible to auto and make co-op slightly less redundant of like farming as time goes on.
Yeah, because I think the threshold between making the game too easy and too hard got so blurred, it wasn't stable enough. And maybe they could have done something with co-op having exclusive rewards where you can only get it by doing co-op. And the revival system was nice, but I think they need to be more lenient on the revival system, because like, yeah, it is punishing when you die once and the run is practically over. I don't think the time limit should have been for like the harder fights. The time limit should have been still 10 minutes instead of 5, because yeah, just messing up once, it's over. I guess it's okay for the legend fights because those fights were only skins, but even some of the farming fights, like Jaldabaoth on release was so difficult to clear because the scales just wiped the team and one revive was not enough.
Yeah, I really think that ignoring legend fight, because that's like the top tier like endgame content, everything other than legend should have been much easier on co-op, because there's a huge barrier to entry. People are gonna like give up. There's no way. Like I think co-op should have been really, really easy. Solo should have been hard, and maybe there should have been like a better reward incentive solo for like a first clear or something, so that both of them have like a decent, like you have a reason to do both. But like I think that they did it wrong.
I think there's a lot of issues that they took. I think they really should have learned from their inspirations a bit more. I've heard a lot of developers were like big fans of specifically Final Fantasy XIV and like other MMOs, which has fights really similar to DL's boss fights. Things about those fights is that you could oftentimes mess up in some parts and recover from it, which wasn't prevalent in every single DL fight. That's my main thing. And Solo should definitely... I do agree with some of the changes to Solo for making AI tankier, because there's no way they're going to make the AI smart enough for every single new unit that comes out. That's just a silly thing to ask.
But honestly, I feel like even some of the modern fights would have been probably a bit more bearable despite all the changes if, you know, there were people still doing them after a while, because once they dropped, with how difficult they winded up being and the tools you needed to clear them, I feel like they weren't as populated in some of the later years compared to other fights. I mean, yeah, obviously as content comes out and becomes older and older, less and less people are gonna have to really run it anymore. They'll be done with their farming. New stuff just seemed to kind of peter out way too quickly, in my opinion. What happened to the community for this game last year? It's weird.
Yeah, I felt like most people just speed farmed it and then just dipped. Like, for example, the Karina cheese for Tartarus. Like, no one used light units to clear that fight. And Donk said this last podcast where people would just take the path of least resistance. And I feel like once you get all those materials, what are you going to do next? You need to at least have fun with the new units that you have. Ferriman, do something. This game isn't just a farm. Like, have fun with the game.
I think overall, another thing is when it actually started to pick up again and get a little interesting with the primal dragons is actually when it decided to just end. I started to accept that there was auto at some point, but still there was an active community that played the content. But it got to a point where if even the primals, they started doing Nihility, was Nihility just going to keep going? When am I going to get my kits back? You would get so strong to a point where you go to the content that actually lets you use your kit, which is Legend Agito, that Legend Agito content, and you would still feel like you wanted more of the new content to allow you to actually use what you invested in. It just started becoming a more market thing. You get the next character that's bypassing Nihility, but still doing the same calculated methods of giving you attack damage, but in a different bracket. Point being, it just felt like you were losing more of the game to try and get people to use new units, but still end up autoing the game.
Yeah, and I would agree that primals started to make the game fun again, because the patterns were unique. For demons, their fights were so linear. Like, until they get to legends, it's so linear and it was uninteractive. And like, the ways that you dealt damage started to get interesting. I thought amping was getting fun because there's so many units that can amp, and keeping up amp was a fun mini task to do. And like, getting affliction res down and timing your afflictions, that started to become fun instead of just relying on double buffs to nuke.
Regarding Nihility, I feel like certain archetype buffs and abilities get shunned out because of how cursed Nihility works, and that kind of killed off, on release, I think like it killed off like 80% of the roster, and that made team comps quite similar, and they had to mix and match to see which one is the best outcome for the faster runs. But I feel like in terms of usability, I think DL could have done 2.0 a bit later post the Hility release, so that like at least more units will be able to use their kits in that fight rather than just the select few. This is so that DL could sell more new units, but as an old player, it feels like the hard work that you put into to your old characters kind of just get nihiled.
Wait, Donkey Max.
Oh, right, my bad. In terms of, like, I just want to go back to Nihility in general. I feel like they didn't handle the situation well at all in general. Nihility itself, because they don't want to directly nerf or touch any units, which I guess is a good thing, but I feel like they did too much of, like, a heavy-handed approach. The mana spirals, think that they implemented those properly either. And shared skills. I honestly think that shared skills were the worst thing that they've ever done in this game. Shared skills completely ruined this game and its balance more than double buffs ever could, because double buffs were the symptom of shared skills. It would never have gotten this bad if every unit couldn't do Katia defense buff skill or something else. Like, you get what I mean, right?
When everyone's super, no one will be.
Exactly. Like, if you have your Emma that can use three defense buffs, then of course double buffs are going to get out of control. I really would have liked to see them implement characters with third and maybe fourth skills. Maybe the weapon skills could stay. I would have liked to see them do that much more, because it could make every character have a niche that they didn't have before. Because we had all these old units that were like really garbage and useless, and mana spirals were supposed to fix them, but then Nihility killed them afterwards anyway. It's just really unfortunate, and I feel like they really dropped the ball on that area.
Yeah, because I felt like Nihility was a gatekeeper of sorts. I mean, you had to get most of the new units, but even like the shared skills that you said, most of the good ones were on limited units. Like Halloween Silas had the double dispel, Nelsa had the faster poison res down. Like, there was a lot of skills that you just could not get. Oh, Seimei too. Like, all those skills were like locked behind limited units, and it just cut a lot of units from, or even a lot of players from even playing the game, because they were lacking those units, even though you could just use the generic defense down skill. Yeah, it just kind of sucked for everyone that just didn't get those units. Nihility, they should have upgraded a lot more 4 stars to be Nihility compatible. Or they should have just demoted a whole bunch of 5 stars that weren't seeing a lot of use that were okay for Nihility. So it's easier for people to get into this content without struggling.
And even if you were still there going through all of this trudge and clearing all this new content with all of the shared skills and units you needed and or sometimes are required to have for an actual smooth clear, you gotta ask yourself back then, who was even there to really celebrate these achievements or really try to make it a bit more lighthearted? Honestly, for such like rough content, you'd think we maybe get a Dark Souls or Elden Ring situation where we make jokes about how rough certain parts were. Everyone talks about Meladia or Morgott and things like that in that game, because they're just so infamously hard for that point, but when you finally beat them, it's like so satisfying. And I don't think anybody in the community much at that year was really upplaying all the tension for these fights. Like, there were like no celebratory memes or any fun content I've seen online a whole lot.
You think people were having
hard
fun
to find if there was
with this game? you think people enjoyed like the latter half of the content? Well, I mean, honestly, I was, and I had much less resources than most people. So, I don't know. I can't speak for other people, but I was having fun.
Having fun near the end as well. And especially during the last week, I cleared a whole bunch of content with people that were trying to get those final clears on those legend fights. It started to get fun when you're trying new shit for no reason. Like, I cleared every single legend fight with all the Cleos. It took a while, but... surprisingly, Forager Cleo can do a lot of damage. I didn't realize she had the defense down Punisher, and God, she hurts with Ciela. But I just think, yeah, there was a lack of creative content. I wouldn't say I was the most successful shit poster on DL, but sometimes I feel like I was the only one.
Oh, I could say there's a couple, well, normal content creators. I'm not saying normal like it's a diss, it's not a diss, but there's normal content creators that are kind of just doing their thing, which I do appreciate. Shout out Zappy, you know, honestly, shout out Zappy. I think that's just the man that carried this community on his back for the latter half of the game. Interest of it kind of started going down more so because of the solo clearing, and then when it came to the end, people wanted to start doing clears for Silas. I mean, I did 3 Laranoa. That's the only thing I basically know at this point. It's been a while, man. A lot of interesting clears were done, and it started making me realize that there were a lot of strong characters in the game, but just never really got the opportunity to shine, because why use them when you could just use this character that has all 3 of those characters' kids in one thing?
Okay, no, I'm sorry. I gotta disagree with that, though, because we were doing funny, wacky clears before that. Dude, I think it's on my channel. Pretty sure I have uploaded a video of 4 Patia clearing Expert Volk from like years ago, way before we started doing like the Laranora stuff and stuff like that. Like, that was from ages ago. And I remember I was doing a decent amount of creative content on Reddit, mostly flexing all of different wacky clearing every single expert I get to fight with Patia. You know, because you can't really use her in the hilly, she's a wet noodle.
And that's where it all started.
baby. But yeah, that's part also is the community just wasn't quite acceptive of that kind of wacky stuff. They wanted more normal stuff that people like Zappy and Archmail posted, which, you know, shout out to them, and we do need normal content like that, but a community needs to embrace both sides, or else, you know, it just kind of gets a bit stale.
Yeah, like, I remember days when there was hosts full of off-meta clears, not just, like, in that little waifu war arc that I remember for a brief period of time, but there were several little, at least, like, simple screenshots of weird characters you never expect getting clears for content of time. You gotta remember, like, back when High Dragons dropped, that stuff was outright divisive with how hard it was. Like, people were complaining. They couldn't just buy their way through this one. They had to actually get good. So to see something random, like, Ciela randomly just clearing this one Brunhilde fight, it's like, whoa, that's out of nowhere. Over time, I think the moderators just started taking down posts as they were considered low effort, despite the fact that pretty sure whoever's fingers were there doing that clear are on fire after posting that. I get that they can maybe spice it up a little bit, but come on, man. You gotta let people know that this stuff is possible. That's the whole reason why I even went on my whole off-meta war path for a bit. I was inspired by posts like those, and the fact they stopped supporting them just really sucks.
And yeah, I think like a decent amount of DL creators, but there were a lot of harmful ones. And do you guys remember Moag DX? I don't know. Like, I've seen his videos everywhere. God, were they bad tutorials. I remember he had, I don't know, like, so many skill damage prints on
Human
Jupiter.
Oh, wait, okay, I know who you're talking about.
God, I made a parody video on it just to see how bad the clear was. It took so long to clear Expert Lilith. Most of the people aren't putting that much effort. They're just getting the video and just posting it. And it's just showcasing a character, but barely. Quilty, he was playing Sabelle and just couldn't keep the clear alive, I'm pretty sure. And
oh, you're bringing back memories. Yeah. I remember, dude, remember when we made those videos parody?
Yeah.
Dude, that was so funny. I love those.
Yeah, they got so mad at us. This whole podcast is entirely despite, what's his name? I don't even remember his name anymore.
His name was Orthodox.
Yeah, Orthodox, because he kicked you out. And the whole joke was to keep adding more people, because his quote for kicking you out was, having a podcast more than 3 people was too much to handle. And we have fucking 6 people right now.
The thing is, though, is that also he was like, oh, we're just gonna keep it to 3 or whatever. And then they had one more episode, and then they didn't make another episode ever again.
Oh.
That's tough. And Honestly, there's only gonna be one creator, though. No offense to anyone else. You guys did what you could. You guys did great. But there was one that went down, and when I noticed they went down, suddenly the play across the board just started getting worse in pubs. I don't know. I swear it was directly correlated. This YouTuber's name was Brodal, and they were just some of the most informative, straightforward, and high-quality content for just the normal game I've seen on the platform. And while there was Dragalia Foundry as a close second, I'd say, right behind them, I think that half of the content creators, like that faction, nothing really truly replaced it. And it would have been really nice to get something or to have them still keep going, because we really needed some guides on some of these fights, because, oh boy, pubs just kept getting worse and worse over time.
Yeah, I could say some of that is due to Moag DX, because a lot of people, he had a lot of views on his content, like people were building horribly, and I kept seeing them in my pubs, but Xenozealous did a good job.
Well, 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 it's Xenozealous, and you are watching Disney Channel.
Of covering the fights, but he didn't go down to the technical level. Brodal went down on how to do good combos when it actually mattered, until they dumbed down the combat to just tap, tap, tap. Like, there's no way to show your skill off besides the time that you take to clear. And sometimes people say it's just cheese and that's why you got it so fast, but there's a lot of skill in the timing and all that stuff, but people just don't appreciate it.
That's why 47MC can clear very fast. They test out everything. They see what characters can quote-unquote cheese the fight. And not only that they can cheese the fight, but they're also pretty good on the teamwork when they time stuff with their abilities and stuff. Without teamwork, I don't think you can get an up fast speed time like they do.
And that's like a really good point, because for a group so talented and skillful, I honestly think the decision to make themselves so secluded for the most part wasn't a good one, at least for the reputation of the game and the community. If you were to see some of the stuff they've done, okay, well, I guess the little embargo's down now, but we got invited to 47MC, me and a buddy. In fact, they're in this call right now. Isn't that right, Sammy? And they showed us an ancient tech for High Brunhilde where you could just certain frame rate and a connection frequency, you could just circle around her and she would just get stuck in the animation for the entire fight.
Wait, you can loop Brunhilde?
Yes, you could circle Brunhilde, and even from what I've seen later on, absurder. But again, this knowledge and everything was kept so secret. I have to blame the time trials for this. They were probably the reason why they got put in the map so hard, because...
Probably. Yeah.
But at the same time, for a cooperative game at its core, the idea of having a competition in the time trial at that point in time, when like the content was new, was not a good idea. People were gonna hide all their secrets at the start. If there was no rewards at stake for the time trial, the entire community would have taken this suddenly newish hard content way better.
I didn't touch time trials like at all, because I just didn't have any units.
Time trials were great. I just want to say that. I just thought they were a cool idea for the community. Not as early as that, but I just thought they were really cool. I did it casually. I think I got top 10% on the one time trial I tried. I almost got a title, actually, for it. I remember one of my friends got a title. Their name's, they're an artist, .png. If you're ever watching this, Sophia, hi. But I remember they got a title. It was super cool that they got something like that. I think cool, like, at least, like, worthless rewards, like, the titles like that were really cool. Did they have summon currency? Did they have Wormite locked behind it? Behind, like, their rewards?
It was just a summon ticket.
They had a little bit.
Yeah, for like what, like top prize or just participating? Because participating is just one thing.
The very first time attacks, this is like pre...
Agito.
Yeah. The very first time attacks, they did have scaling rewards with like summon tickets and Wormite and stuff like that. But then all of the ones after that were just titles. They didn't have anything like that again.
I think that was good though, to just have titles. People will fight tooth and nail for any crumb of summon currency. It's a gacha game.
I'm really glad because I didn't feel like I was missing out anymore. So I just stopped worrying about it.
And they had participation, like... they count as separate quests?
I did all of them. I just didn't care to get a high time because the title didn't mean that much to me in that case. Yeah. And I couldn't really like compete with other people anyway because I didn't have the units.
No, yeah, totally fair. I think a cool idea for that might have been to have a set pool of units and gear. You have to perform as fast as you can with that. Remember one of the time trials, it came down to, it was a bit cheesy, and you had to rely on getting a certain amount of crits in order to get certain times. And that's how people grind just to get crits, to get in that time, which is kind of mostly what time trials were four, is just part of luck, part of skill. It was still kind of fun though, I think. I mean, not the first one though for currency, but like the titles and stuff, I think that's a cool idea.
So aside from time trials, I feel like the community did try in terms of art. We did have a lot of artists on Twitter you know, I'm gonna need y'all to help me shout them out. Like I said, I'm getting old man syndrome right now. My face kind of numb. But point being, shout them out in the comments. There's a lot of artists that actually did carry the game. I feel like a lot of members of the community as well at least tried to keep it active. Transitioning off of COVID, we started having life things to do. And I feel that's when it kind of felt the community wasn't as active because less people were just chilling at home, becoming super tryhards at the game. And it's just kind of, you know, going through life, going through school, you know, all that stuff. But the community did try to stay active and still tries to stay active right now, even with the revived version of the game. Shout out to Dawn Shard. Yeah.
I just wanted a quick note. I have 982 Cleo arts.
That's normal. That's normal.
So the art community is definitely alive. Oh, yeah, it's just slowly dropping off though.
I will never not flex. I'm responsible for like half of all Patia fan art.
That's true.
I stop the recent times, but you know, this podcast might give me another piece or two.
I gotta give a big shout out to my man, Suzu. He's been someone I've known in a sort of extra secret server for quite some time now, and he's been keeping the Dragalia blood alive, if slightly. He's focused more on Genshin and Fire Emblem these days, but he still gives homage to where we basically started, and I gotta really appreciate him for that. So yeah, do check out his stuff if you ever get the chance. The name is Ryo Suzuki. You might have already seen it if you're a Dragalia fan yourself. He's posted in the Reddit before, but honestly, the end of the day, despite all the shortcomings, there was legitimately fantastic content in this game. And like the artists and everyone else afterwards still making content despite the game being dead goes to show that there's still a care and a passion for the characters, stories, lore, and gameplay for Dragalia Lost. Every mobile game I've played, even alongside DO when it was still running, just didn't hit the same. I don't know what it is. I get it. It was the most generous gacha in the market. The content wasn't pay to win, surprisingly, for a good while. And there was just so much charm and effort putting into it. I thought, this is it. This is the mobile game. So apologies if I can't really give praises to a lot of the big things coming out. Not going to name any specific names, but I'm sorry. This game just hit different. It really did. Not a lot's going to live up to it to me, regardless of all its faults.
I think, like, every time in the morning, I would play DL just to keep my brain going, you know, keep my brain functions up so that, like, it doesn't rot literally in dust. The reason why is, like, DL is just so proactive. You're actually using your brain, muscle memory, reactions whatsoever when you're dodging. But I do feel like the one thing I'm glad about DL is that, thankfully, it does not turn my phone into a microwave on boot up like Genshin Impact. And it does not drain my battery that quick.
Well, hey, there is a good news. If you at least want to relive some of those memories and still sort of experiment with things you might not have gotten to before in the game, well, I don't really know if there's a way. I can't really say for sure. Something's really keeping me from kind of confirming this, but I hear there may be some weird, like, file or something floating out there that you might want to avoid. Because it may contain some traces of, like, Dragalia's gameplay. I mean, it doesn't really look like it at all. I can't really tell for sure. But if you do see it, and you see anything that seems like a shard in the dawn of the day, you might want to avoid it, you know, because you don't want to get any virus or anything. It might have Dragalia's data or something, but I think it's probably bait, yeah.
But definitely try not to get into imitations like spires that contain dragons, because I heard those are just disappointing.
Personally, I think DL was the only reason why I stopped playing gachas. There's just not something that's going to be the same with it. Like, DL took me out of League of Legends for 2 years. I stopped playing League for 2 years because of DL. I was having so much fun doing co-op and just grinding the game because I had people to play with. But now it's just, I'm going back to League, so I'm kind of sad that I don't have DL to stop the addiction. So.
I'm so sad about that. I'm going back to League.
It's like relapsing into a drug.
Oh, someone save me. I'm going back to League.
This is a cry for help.
No, man.
Help, man. I don't want to go back to League.
You love League of Legends. It's great.
Yeah. DL made me a better League of Legends player. I'm joking. But DL honestly made me realize that even in simple games, even though it's a bit repetitive, you can still have fun just because of variation in those simple games. It was just a circle every single year, every single fight. But in what they did within a circle, always kind of felt like it was a lot more than what we realized. And when you do it in co-op as opposed to solo, only have the one pattern on the main controlled character, you could actually see why the game was built the certain way, you know, in fights like Primal, Zodiac, or even the original Master Jupiter fights, you would always have to coordinate yourself in certain areas without even communicating with people in voice chats. So it's kind of like a telekinetic or like a societal way of learning how to do your job without telling each other their job because of experience. And that's why I love this game.
Yeah, I think DL really brought out the most of my theory crafting abilities. Thinking about the game or like possibilities of what a dragon or what a character could impact an element could do, it was just so fun to think about. It's just, you don't really get that in a lot of games anymore. I mean, you do, but like, not to the extent of DL. Something so small like Nyx, you didn't think it was going to make a big impact by just reading it, but when you actually got Nyx and played him, it just changed how the game was played. It literally warped light around it. I just think losing DL dulled out my brain because my theory craft ability isn't as good as it used to be.
This game had a lot of, like, there were so many things that you could do with the game. There were so many options, and people, like, kind of disappointing that everyone stuck to the meta. Because, for example, in Legend Cayenne, nobody thought of using Vita, even though Vita was a crazy niche unit for that fight, and nobody thought of using her until I used it. And I posted that one post on Reddit, and suddenly she's really, really good, and then people that aren't clearing, that had really hard trouble clearing, are just clearing very easily. I post something of a 3-star unit nobody really cared about, turns out they have like a hidden interaction, and it's just an easy fight now. There were many other cases with different units, obviously not to that degree. Any time that I did a fight or anything like that, to like look at every single unit in my roster and be like, okay, what can I do with them? And everybody could do that, but I don't know, I feel like it was partially the game and then partially our community, and it was just really, really unfortunate that I had to go this way, but you know, it is what it is.
Now, this might sound a little cheesy, but the game's theme overall and the story and everything was always about forging bonds with others and just how strong they can be in the face of adversity. And through the early years of this game, and maybe even some of the later ones, what co-op content there was absolutely helped me form some everlasting bonds. The amount of connections, people, and friends I've made through just strategizing, theory crafting, memeing about the game is astronomical. I have never met this many people that I thoroughly trust and care for in such a relatively short amount of time through one piece of media. And I can't even say that for something as all-consuming as Pokemon, of all things. Can you believe it? This one little side game and side game's entire repertoire managed to net me more connections than anything I've ever experienced before. The co-op for this game, I think, is one of the biggest reasons why that happened. The core of this game still shines through all the friends I've made, through all the servers, and everything else. I want to thank you, Okada, and Psy Games for giving this idea a chance. Maybe one day, y'all will recognize it again in full. Maybe even give it some new life. I doubt it, but man can dream.
No, you're not allowed to.
I'm sorry, I just looked in the chat and I saw Man's offense views. I love that fucking emote.
That was the worst emote ever. Holy crap.
I heard it in my head. I'm like,
offense, please. Like, damn, I suck. Fine, I'll leave. See ya. All of the supports going offense, please, and you're like the DPS. And then
I was that asshole. I was a gatekeeper.
I was not allowed to be a gatekeeper because I'm the one that brought people down. Because I remember I got my first Twins weapon purely with Padia because I had no good water units at the time. So I farmed my first Twins weapon with Padia.
Yo, I struggled with all of the wind content because I had no good fire units. Like, my best unit was Ezreal, and they put Nihility up, so I was like, okay, what do I do now? Like, I was using Ezreal, and I'm like, yeah, this game is so easy, and then they put Nihility, and I'm like, oh, actually so cringe.
Hey, you did say that you wanted more of a reason to pay for units, because you shouldn't be able to clear everything solo easily with no spending.
Well, yes, but they should have done that better. There's no way I'm going to agree with how they did it. That was giga cringe.
It was. But no, seriously, I am not kidding when I say that DL has brought me the most and closest of my friends I've ever had in my entire life. Even surpassing Splatoon, and that game literally saved my life. I'm just really grateful for DL and for all of you, and the fact that despite the mess and despite all the bumps and turns in the process of the game eventually getting it shut down, I am grateful that it ever always happened just because of all it did for me and for meeting with y'all and all that stuff. All the memes and all the characters, it's a lot. Man, I can't really express it in words, especially because I'm absolutely garbage with words. But I'm always going to be thankful for this game. No matter how old, like 20 years from now, I'm probably still going to be going, oh yeah, Dragalia? Yeah, something like that. Oh yeah, I met some cool guys there. I'm still gonna be like that years from now, just because it meant that much, just being able to meet so many people. So thank y'all.
It's kind of funny, I almost quit DL because they didn't pull DY Cleo. I got her on Christmas. It was funny. I was like, damn, I'm gonna quit this game, bro. I want this character because I like her so much. And then like, damn, I got her on Christmas. Let's fucking go.
I think I had, what, 5,000 minutes on this game? That's not my proudest, but the same damn enjoyment of seeing Big Number using CL. No, not CL. I didn't even get her. Using Summer Marishite to pop off on you hoes and get 1 million bleed with Ieyasu. You think that shit isn't fucking lit? Are you crazy? That game literally made you look at trash and turn trash into gold. You bitches don't know gold until you see that game, because you turn your mold into gold and you'll be sold.
Why are you rapping?
That's what I don't know at this point. I just kind of missed that game. I mean, I played the Dawnshot version, but I really do miss the live service, because we could have gone to 1,000 characters and I bet you people would still take their filthy wallets to spend a freaking 1,000 on maid costume Yuden with the freaking
what? No, I would have uninstalled, man.
Yes, sir.
I would have done that. That would, they you know, yeah, that would have saved the game. The game wouldn't have been dead if they released.
Yes, sir. I'd endorse you too.
I guess now we can just see if any Dragalia characters get into GBF Rising.
That's not happening. They don't want this game to ever see the light of day again.
Dude, they're not even adding Pekarin. They're adding Pekarin as like an avatar. They're not adding her as a full character.
They would rather add in 2B and whatever the heck.
Why 2B? Add another Slagames.
I'm actually upset at that.
Pekarin would have been great. It would have made me buy the game. I'm not even that big of a Princess Connect.
They should add in Persona so that the game dies a year later.
True. I love that chart that he keeps on updating of the collabs of Persona 5 and then dies a year later. It just keeps on going.
The gift so that keeps funny. On giving.
I predicted that, by the way, on our first podcast. I called it.
And here we are. And speaking of and here we are, where was the Kirby collab? In fact, where were the Nintendo collabs in general? The only one we got was
Fire Emblem Heroes.
Yeah, Fire Emblem. And Heroes is not even a direct main title.
Bro, if we got a Zelda collab, that would have saved the game.
Surely we needed more Fire Emblem characters. Surely.
First it was Smash, now it was Dio. What's next? Or no, please Nintendo, don't take that idea, please!
Yes, please. I want to play as Marth, and I want to run people over as Marth. I want that. Give me that.
Damn. It's really been 5 years, huh?
5 years too many. Ayo!
I just realized DL took a fifth of my life, bro.
Yeah, I'm happy birthday.
He's gone.
We're a bunch of Zoomers that turned into freaking Wojacks, bro. After the game died. Oh my god.
Turned into Wojacks.
Yes.
Yo, like, any of you very gifted Dragalia players out there, if you can, like, get some Dragalia mod with these upcoming Monster Hunters or the ones that come out, I'd love that. Let's face it here. If you want to, like, get this sort of experience in a bit more of a bigger budget, I'd check out Monster Hunter. They got some sales going on now, and I think that's honestly would still help our community indirectly. As cope as that sounds, but trust me, that would do us a favor. Check those out.
Hashtag ad, hashtag sponsor, hashtag...
I promise we're not sponsored.
Give me all your money.
We gotta bring up replacements.
Alright. Any last points before we close out?
I was always right about the summons. Everyone else is wrong.
Uncle Carter.
DL's in play.
Crisis Edge.
Crisis Edgy.
The bar was the most done dirty foster in the game, and you cannot convince me otherwise. Hail to the Egyptian Queen.
Patio's the best character.
I'm sorry, but Cleo is the greatest.
You know, all of you are wrong. Is actually Patio?
It's over. I won.
Hey there! Remember that little bone payment I asked Sammy for in one of our podcasts? I think you're next on my little list. So how about you hand that over by APM?
Uh-oh. You're in trouble. Not the
you're
bone zone.
You're in danger.
All right. Thanks, everybody, for